This is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today I have a very special treat for you. We're gonna go to Swank Specialty Produce, which is here in Loxahatchee, Florida. They're a specialty grower of hydroponic and soilless field grown crops. And we're here on a really fun day. Today is the farm to table luncheon day. So normally they don't have any signs disclosing their address because they are only basically a wholesaler or direct to the public through the CSAs or the local West Palm Beach green market, so they don't normally accept visitors. So I'm so happy to be here to be able to go on a tour and share with you guys the luncheon and what they're growing hydroponically and in the field here at Swank Specialty Produce. So let's head down the road and I'm gonna get my Swank on. So we're here today on a special day at Swank Farm. This is a farm to table luncheon where they're having a lunch which is benefiting the organization Slow Food, a Glades to Coast chapter, I believe. And what that is today is you pay a set price for a nice lunch and actually some nice hors d'oeuvres that they have right here, including heirloom carrots. Here's a purple carrot here. Man, never tasted better. I bet this is right from the field. Next, we're gonna go over to the luncheon and show you guys a glimpse of that and how that's happening. At the luncheon, they get farm fresh picked produce from this farm and other farms in the area. Made into a lunch, but the bonus for me is actually you get a personal tour of Swank Farms by the owners. So that was incredible. I went on that already and we'll show you a little glimpse and maybe a clip of that in a little bit. But today I'm going to give you a personal tour myself with my insight on how they're growing here. Now, Darren has been growing food for the last 10 years here. So, you know, on a commercial scale. So he's dealing with this day in and day out, and he is definitely a wealth of knowledge, and every time I come I have almost a list of questions to ask him. Hey Darren, what do you think about this? What do you think about this? And I could gain knowledge from his everyday real world experiences, literally in the trenches, growing food so that people can be healthier and actually taste real food for probably the first time in their lives. Here are just two of the appetizers that they had that were picked fresh here at the farm, and these plates are absolutely beautiful. Check it out, these are some heirloom carrots from the farm. I see like white, yellow, red, orange, and even purple carrots, and let me tell you, these guys are absolutely delicious. In addition, they got the colorful cauliflower platter here. Look at this, it's actually yellow. They have a green cauliflower, a purple cauliflower, and even a white cauliflower. So I want to remind you guys that you guys want to eat your foods of color, because the foods of color have different antioxidants that are really good for us. Everybody's having a great time here at this farm to table luncheon. They got music playing, everybody's just enjoying themselves. Before the farm to table luncheon, what happened was they went on a tour. But next, let me go ahead and show you guys a little quick clip of the tour that everybody at this farm to table luncheon got to take, including me. Now, these tours like this are only available if you come out to one of these luncheons, because normally you won't have any access to the Swank Farm like I do today. But luckily, you're here with me, so you're gonna get to see everything they do. And what I'm gonna relate this to is on their large scale farm here, where they keep expanding every time I come and visit. If you're growing in your backyard, like I would encourage you to do, because the best food is gonna come from your backyard that you grew with your own hands, that you know what's going in the soil, or a trusted farm like Swank Farm. They use natural and organic growing practices and include things like clay and ocean water to add the minerals and the elements to this food so that it actually tastes good. It's Darren's belief, and he's the farmer here, that, you know, people don't eat food because it doesn't taste good. I mean, if you go down to the store and buy a head of cauliflower, it just tastes like you're almost eating cardboard. Well, maybe not that bad. But his cauliflower here has a real flavor and a real taste, because when you're tasting the food, you're actually tasting the minerals, the vitamins, the phytochemicals, the nutrients in the food, and that makes it taste good for us. And when we're eating cardboard food or food produced on large agricultural farms that they're just pumping out food that's large because they get paid for it by the pound, it may not have the nutritional density that we need to be optimally healthy. So I'd highly encourage you to grow your own food or support a place like Swank where you can get that high quality food so that you can be as healthy as you can. Sign up for their CSA where they deliver to all different places in South Florida, and you could get the food that's grown here. In addition, they sell a lot of the crops here to the high-end restaurants around South Florida. So if you're a chef looking for the best quality stuff, let me tell you, it's here at Swank. Anyways, today's episode, what we're gonna do is we're gonna compare what they do at Swank on a large scale to feed South Florida to a smaller level to what you do in your backyard. So if you grow in your backyard, you're gonna go through the same steps that they go through here. And I'm gonna take you to all the different areas of the farm to show you the steps, and then I'll also relate that to how you can do the same at home to grow your own high quality food if you don't live in South Florida and can't get the food grown here at Swank Farm. Now we're in the Swank Farm greenhouse, and this is where the magic all starts. It first starts with the seeds. And I know Darren is using some high quality seeds, most of which he gets from Johnny Select Seeds. They have a nice variety of all kinds of different seeds that you can purchase even if you're a home gardener. So you can start with the same seeds, or many of the same seeds that Darren uses here. They put these into their starter trays right here. Just put them in and check it out. Just in a little bit, they start to sprout up. And what these are called flood tables. And what happens is the water is pumped in, floods this up, keeps it wet, gets it nice and moist, and then he lets it drain down, and then it stays a bit moist, and then that allows for the plants to start and sprout up. As the plants continue to grow, they just sprout up, and you can see right here in the front of the camera is some lettuce growing. They have all other kinds of baby plants that are growing in here. Once they're to a certain size, they'll take and transplant all these plants into either their shade house or just the field grown organically produced crops. So how can seeing all this relate to you as a home gardener? Very simply, you want to get some trays, maybe like this one, and I had an episode a couple times back that show how to start seeds. So whether you start seeds in peat pots, peat pellets, or just some little, you know, seed mixture or even compost, you want to start your seeds, and normally you're going to maybe do them in a greenhouse, but if you don't have one, that's all right. You can do it on your kitchen table. Even in your garage, you may need to put some lighting on there. You need to keep them moist. Very simple, very easy. And then once you have your plants and they grow, then you're gonna transplant them out. But it's important to use a good source of water. Here at Swank Farm, they draw from three different wells on property, and the water that comes out of the wells doesn't have chlorine or fluoride that may stunt your plants' growth. So they use that well water to water the field crops that are grown in bags, and then they actually use a filtration system, reverse osmosis system, to take out all the impurities in the water so that they can feed that water to their hydroponic shade house and just put in exactly what they need to have the high quality crops that they grow here. So next, let's take a look at the filtration system, or their big RO system that they're using here. We're here at their filtration setup. Now this is their RO system that they use to filter the water that they're going to feed the hydroponically grown plants. Now, in a home environment, I don't necessarily think you need an RO system, maybe if you're doing hydroponics, but in your home garden, if you're on city water, I would highly encourage you to get some filtration to filter out the things like chlorine and possibly fluoride so that they don't build up in your plants. In addition, sometimes if your water is actually very alkaline, you water your plants with the alkaline water, it could actually imbalance your soil, because think about it, you're watering day after day and putting more minerals back into your soil, which may change the soil pH over time. So definitely water filtration is very important, and I'm glad to say that they're using some good quality water here because they are filtering it. So how can that help you as a home gardener? Well, it's very simple. Filter your water for the best growing results. So after the plants come out of the little greenhouse area as small babies, then they get transplanted into two places, either the shade house, which is grown under hydroponics, or number two, the field. So hey, let's go check out that field next. So here's just one of the fields where the little baby plants get planted out in, and you'd be saying, hey John, nothing's planted in the field. They're all in these little like bags here. Well, that's right. Because this is South Florida, a lot of the ground here is sand. And the ground also may introduce pests. So what they do here is they grow in grow bags. So you could think of a grow bag as a little like plastic garbage bag that's heavy duty, that has small holes for drainage, but they're UV resistant so they don't break down quite as fast as a garbage bag would. And they fill it up with a mixture of Florida peat, which is a locally produced peat moss, and some perlite. So that's a SoilLess mixture. And then they add in the organic nutrition the plants need to thrive. Darren here is a strong believer in mycorrhiza, and like I am too, and I'm sure he's found that the mycorrhiza has made his plants grow larger and yield more and also taste better, but most importantly, make his plants healthy, because healthier plants are easier to tend to than unhealthy plants. If you have healthy plants, then they're more disease and pest resistant to plants that are unhealthy. And I think that same thing applies to us. The healthier we are, the more resistant we are to getting sick. So if you eat, you know, maybe food that's not so healthy, maybe will be so healthy, and maybe that's a problem in America today, in my opinion. The other thing I want to really touch on for you guys at home is the pots. So he's using the bags, the grow bags. You could use plastic bags at home. I prefer the smart pots that are more reusable on a commercial scale like this. That probably would get too expensive, but smart pots are gonna last longer, you know, for a longer period of time, but they cost a little bit more. In addition, if you're at home, you may be growing in a raised bed. And depending on your soil, so if you have sandy soil, you know, that may have problems with it, that's contaminated or whatnot, growing in bags or growing in a raised bed that has the bottom sealed off may be an excellent way to grow, so that you don't get any soil contamination or anything like that. So for me, I actually like to grow in a raised bed with the bottoms open, because my soil is not contaminated, so I can kind of get some of the earthworms come up from the bottom and get in my soil and just basically let nature take its course. Next, what we're gonna do is we're gonna walk around this field of crops and just kind of pinpoint a few of them. One of the things you're gonna notice is that he has incredible diversity. He's just not all growing, you know, 2,000 crops of cauliflower. He has cauliflower, collard greens, Asian greens, beets, leeks, peppers, tomatoes. He's growing all kinds of stuff. And you know what? In my opinion, farms should be a genetic diversity of all kinds of different crops, not only because we should be eating a variety of crops, but also because it's easier to deal with the pests if you grow a wide variety of things. For example, if he gets some kind of crazy pest that only attacks cauliflower, that could take out his, I don't know, 100 or 200 foot row of cauliflower, so he won't make the money off that, but maybe that same pest won't attack his beet, so he still has something to fall back on if he needs to. And that can be very important for a home gardener to ensure that you still have something to eat if something, for example, attacks your tomato plants, but they didn't get your peppers or your, you know, spaghetti squash. So you're always gonna have something to eat if you diversify. So remember, diversity is the spice of life. Grow bags in this area are growing cabbage. So, you know, these grow bags are not very big. So say you have a patio, you can grow things in a grow bag or just a standard nursery pot. I would encourage you to use the biggest size pot as you possibly can. Now you can see it has kind of like a red cabbage here and a green cabbage. And this is kind of just to show you that this is some of that diversity that he's growing here. I think he's growing three varieties of cabbages this year. And guess what? Each tastes a little bit different and they have a different nutrient profile. I mean, the red pigments in this cabbage basically have different nutrition than this one. Plus they taste different. So if you're a gourmand chef or somebody into food, you can get some red and green cabbage and it's gonna taste a little bit differently. And once again, diversity may solve some pest problems, because maybe a pest only likes the red stuff and not the green stuff, or vice versa. So I would encourage you to plant diversity in your garden, including several different varieties of the same plant, so that in case there is a pest problem, maybe some of your crops will still make it. In addition, each different variety of crop may have different nutrient profiles, but also taste just a little bit different for that perfect recipe that you're gonna make with the food you grew at home. We're in another area of the field that's growing beets. He's got some standard red beets, and also behind me he's got the orange beets. So once again, more diversity. So another thing that's really cool is right here, these are the carrots growing. And when you think carrot, you might think the color orange, because you know what? Carrots are orange, right? Well, no. Not all carrots are orange. Actually, original carrots weren't even orange. They came in things like purple and white and red and yellow, only because they've been hybridized and grown to basically make the sweet long carrots that we know today, is that they're orange. And those are the ones that are commercially available. But if you support a local farm here, like Swank Farm, or grow carrots yourself at home, you're gonna get carrots like this. And man, this is definitely a beauty here. Man, that's a nice one there. And the other thing you'll notice is that, you know, Sometimes in nature, carrots don't grow exactly like the nice, long, cylindrical ones. But you know what? Each piece of produce is unique. This actually happens to be a red carrot right here, and we're gonna go ahead and pick off some of these roots. And there's the red carrot, just kind of picked off all the little roots and all the pieces and got rid of some of that dirt. And you know what? That's the best carrot I've ever had in Florida. This is an heirloom red carrot. Man, and they just don't taste as good in the stores. This carrot is not super sweet, but it has an intense, like, carrot flavor that you've probably never tasted before unless you've grown it yourself or actually fresh picked it at a farm that's using natural growing practices. You might be saying, hey, John, didn't you just eat some soil? Well, yeah, there's some soil on here, but I'm not concerned about that because this is a family-run farm. Darren and his wife and his three children work here on the farm religiously every single day. I mean, this is a big operation, and I think he works like 80 hours a week. So, you know, farming is definitely hard work. But he grows things in a natural way because, you know, at any time his kids might come around and start eating stuff, and he doesn't want to poison them with things like pesticides. So he only uses OMRI certified controls for insects. Actually, and let's check out another control besides a control that you spray on. He uses a few other things such as a mechanical control that we'll take a look at next. So behind me is the mechanical control he's using to prevent bugs from invading and eating his pepper plants. There's a pest here in Florida that will eat your peppers. Actually, the little bugs lay eggs, I guess, in the buds, and then they'll actually eat and devastate your crop. So instead of spraying something, he's using a mechanical control, which is easy as building a frame out of PVC and wood and putting a agricultural cloth over it so that the bugs can't get in. Now, because the cloth is white, it still lets the sun in so the plants can continue to grow, and he has his irrigation going all through there so they're still getting watered. So in this way, he can keep the pests out and not have to use any sprays to spray for pests. So how could this help you at home? Well, you could easily enclose just part of your garden, even just one raised bed, so that the bugs and pests can't get in there as an alternative to spraying or other controls. In this area, what they're growing is the green cauliflower. So this cauliflower is actually green in color. They've actually gone through and pretty much harvested both these rows of cauliflower, maybe except for this. They have actually left some go to flower, which is quite cool to see, you know, after the cauliflower forms that head that we're used to, it actually forms into a flower, makes all these nice little yellow flowers that are edible. And I remind you guys that even after you harvest your cauliflower, the leaves around the cauliflower, so they harvested the cauliflower that was right here, they're left with all these leaves that I don't know what they're gonna do with. But if you're a home gardener, even if they're here, what they should do, in my opinion, and what you should do, is harvest these leaves. These leaves actually have nice thick stems, really hard to break off. But these guys are great for using in salads, for cooking, for juicing, or even blending up. So what I would do if I had the resources they had at this farm is I'd bag up or sell in bunches, a whole bunch of these cauliflower greens as juicing greens to people at the farmer's market because, you know, there's a lot of people juicing and they want an affordable source of locally grown greens, which these quite are. So here, I'll even taste it. Wow, actually, that's a really good flavor. I wouldn't mind just chopping this up and put it in a salad with a good, delicious salad dressing. So don't forget, eat your cauliflower leaves, also your broccoli leaves. Besides just the flour that we see in the stores, the leaves are absolutely edible and they're absolutely delicious. We're in yet another field where they're growing turnips in a grow bag. Now, yes, the turnip greens are edible, but most people don't eat them. I like to actually juice them or blend them up. You can see in this small little grow bag, they're growing 10 turnips. So you mean the grow bag's not even that wide and they have a lot of food grown in here. So if you are growing at home, what you want to remember is that you want to maximize the space. Here on the farm, they want to maximize the space because the more stuff they grow, the higher their income will be. But at home, you know, we all need to eat. The more you're growing, the more you're going to be eating and the more money you're gonna be saving. Now the moment I've been waiting for, and maybe you have too, we're gonna get to go into this big, huge shade house where things are growing both hydroponically and in the grow bags. The shade house is just massive. They have all these grow tables for the hydroponics and also things in grow bags. They're growing peppers here, more peppers there, beans down there, and all kinds of leafy greens and herbs to supply the local community. And this is the same food that was actually just used in that luncheon there. What we're gonna do next is actually go around to a few areas of this shade house, and I'm gonna point out a few techniques that can be useful for you to know as a home gardener. One of the things that's really important to Darren is growing a diversity of crops, and as you can see on these tables here, there's just a variety of different crops. I think these are some Asian greens, more Asian greens. He's got lettuce, maybe radishes grown for microgreens, all kinds of different things. And that will take this opportunity also to remind you guys that you guys want to eat your greens. Greens are the most nutritionally dense foods on the planet, especially if they're grown in high quality nutrients like they're grown here at Swank. And that's why I recommend you use things like rock dust, clay, and even ocean grown or ocean solution minerals to add the trace minerals back into the soil. So I'm really impressed here with Darren. He's growing things that I thought he'd never grow, including stinging nettles. So stinging nettles are an incredible edible, what's thought of as a weed, but in a really powerful medicinal plant that's used as an herb. But you can also eat the leaves, although that does have stingers, so I would encourage you to actually blend them up or juice them to get rid of the stingers. But it looks like they do great under hydroponics, rivaling even ones grown in my garden. Another thing I want to touch on is actually right in front of the camera there. I don't know if you could see it. It's so small and tiny. But inside the shade house here, there's many spiders. Now, you know, they're not using insecticides or anything to kill the spiders because spiders are part of nature. And they can actually help the home gardener and help the commercial farmer because they will eat the bad bugs. The only thing that's maybe a negative is when you're walking around in the shade house to harvest, you'll run into all these webs. How can this help you as a home gardener? Well, you want to encourage nature to happen in your garden. Nature is a complete system that's been working for millions of years, and you know there's checks and balances in nature, just like in our government. Here's yet another crop being grown on a hydroponics table underneath here somewhere. Here it is. This is a hydroponics table, and this is a crop that is literally taking off. So these are nasturtiums, and I love the nasturtium flowers. They're definitely nice and edible, have a nice little spicy flavor, and these ones are actually really rich and deep in pigments. I would encourage you to grow flowers in your garden, not only to attract beneficial insects, but also to eat. All the different colorings in the flowers are good for us to eat, and in addition, nasturtium flowers, the leaves, and even the little seeds are edible. Actually, the seeds are called poor man's capers. This is the area with all the tomatoes growing, and they have these growing vertically in a hydroponic system. This is absolutely amazing. I mean, look at this. These things are loaded up with these yellow tomatoes here, and behind me we got the standard red ones. All different colors. He's growing many different varieties of tomatoes, and I'm sure he's doing that to find out which tomato variety produces the most and actually does the most in his exact system here and his exact climate here. So once again, growing a diversity is very important. Plus, he may have certain chefs that only want, wow, the peach tomatoes. Man, those things are kind of furry, and those ones are definitely ripe and probably gonna be really good also. So what can you learn from this? Well, if you're growing at home, it's very important to grow vertically. He's growing vertically to maximize his space, which is gonna maximize his income, but at home, you may not have enough space. So grow vertically so that you can grow more and thusly eat more too. This is the errand that they're using bumblebees as the pollinators for the different fruiting crops, such as the peppers and tomatoes here in the shade house. Now it's very important that your plants are properly pollinated. Hey, I think I like pollinating. But your plants need to be properly pollinated so that it ensures the highest possible yields for you. So while you could get some bumblebees, what I would encourage you to do is get some honeybees. So not only can you produce your own honey, but they will effectively increase your yields because they will increase the pollination on your property and the surrounding areas. Here's literally a field of greens. I mean, they're growing so many leaves and crops to feed people. It's absolutely incredible. They're growing a variety of greens here in the shade house here at Swank Specialty Produce. I hope you've enjoyed this episode and learned some things from the experts, literally a commercial grower that grows on a commercial scale that has been profitable for the last 10 years, and he's slowly and ever expanding his business so that he can feed more people and get this high nutrient density food out to people. Hopefully as home gardeners, you've also learned a few things that you can model in your home garden so that you too can also be a success. If you do live in the South Florida area and are not growing your food, I would highly encourage you to visit the Swank's website, swankspecialtyproduce.com, to learn about their CSA program so you can purchase some of these delicious fruits and vegetables that they're growing here in South Florida. They also show up to the farmer's market, it's called the Green Market in West Palm Beach, every Saturday. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com, encouraging you to keep on growing.